Okay, and as usual, here we go. Okay, so yeah, thank you very much, Volodya, and I will give only one talk, and next week, Carlo Danieli, who's here, will give a second talk on a related subjects and results. Okay, so I will give you some little warm-up, which is on discrete breathers, which we already mentioned here, I think, and on some hard problems and legacy. Then I will say just a few pedestrian views, share some pedestrian views on many body localization, in particular in clean systems, and then I will come to the main part of the talk, where we will discuss the dynamics of systems, non-integrable systems, in the proximity of some integrable limit, and some perhaps interesting results. Right, so the work is done, not only this, but also a series of other projects are done together with David Campbell, who is still supposed to arrive to this meeting here, Kalo, who is in the audience, and Mitun and Yagmur from our center in Daejeon, Korea, and some related work has been also done together with Alexander Cherny from Dubna and Thomas Engel, who was with us in Daejeon. So, first I want just to, as a warm-up, to show you a few results on the impact which these creatures called discrete breathers or intrinsic localized modes may have on the dynamics of Hamiltonian lattices. Discrete breathers by themselves are exact solutions, time-periodic and spatially localized solutions on Hamiltonian networks, usually translationally invariant ones, but not necessarily. And what has been known since quite some time is that these excitations have been probed in quite an impressive variety of different physical settings, as you can see from this short list here, and you can find more on this in various reviews. But there are a few hard problems, and one of them is, not the only one, but one of them is what is the impact of these excitations, of these exact solutions, on the dynamics of such systems at equilibrium, and also on the relaxational dynamics of such systems when being excited to some very abnormal non-equilibrium state. And what you see, for instance, here in this simulation here is a two-dimensional lattice of anharmonic oscillators with nearest neighbor coupling. And you start the system in a highly non-equilibrium state, namely in you excite a plane wave, slightly corrugated, and then you let the system go. What you see here is the evolution of the energy density in the system as time goes on. And then what you find is that after some modulational instability, this plane wave breaks down into these hot spots, which suck a lot of energy into them and are very similar to exact discrete breather solutions, which then survive for very long times on a background of delocalized cold waves which roam through the system, seemingly not speaking to each other. Clearly, this is not a state of thermal equilibrium. These excitations should decay, maybe be excited at other places. But this relaxation towards equilibrium appears to be hindered by precisely the excitation of these breather-like hotspots. And in a second, no, I have a problem. In a second, yeah, here we go. Simulation, you can do the opposite. You first excite the same system, two-dimensional lattice, to some random initial state, which looks pretty nice and thermal. But then you add cooling at the boundaries, and this cooling at the boundaries will dissipate all the excitations away which reach the boundaries. And what you see after some time is a very similar situation, that these delocalized excitations, cold excitations, which are in the system reach the boundaries and are dissipated away, but a bunch of hot spots or breather-like excitations remain inside. And then the question is, were they always there? Are they part of thermal equilibrium, or what is actually going on? And then there's also a set of issues which one could put into a kind of a legacy of these discrete breather studies. And one of them is can be found in the problem of Fermi-Pasta-Nulam, which I think was already discussed by Felix, where, as you know, an excitation of a low-frequency mode is supposed to decay through interactions with other higher frequency modes such that you will ultimately reach a state of thermal equilibrium. But this process is not happening, or at least is not happening on a very long time scales. And what you see is that only a few low frequency modes are excited, but the high frequency modes, which correspond to these large Q values, are not excited. And you have to wait maybe an astronomical time until this will happen. Although the system is apparently non-integrable and things actually should relax into a state of thermal equilibrium. Why this is a legacy is because you can connect to some extent this phenomenon to the existence of, again, exact time periodic solutions in that very non-integrable system, no integrable approximation needed. And these time periodic solutions are now localized in frequency or normal mode space and coined Q breathers. So you could relate again things here and see again that there's there are, if you wish, periodic orbits, and these exact periodic orbits, even though they exist in a non-integrable system, and even though they have maybe measure zero, seem to have a very strong impact on the relaxation of the system from a non-equilibrium state into a state of thermal equilibrium. Good. So with this little warm-up, let me mention that what we did more recently, together with Carlo and David Campbell, is we wanted to measure more precisely the time such FPU experiment, if you want, will need in order to reach equilibrium. So what we did is we decided to choose a certain observable. In that case, it was taken from the literature, and it is a kind of an entropy measure which tells you how the energy is distributed amongst the different normal modes. And then we followed this observable in time, and we waited until it first, for the first time, reaches its phase space average, or Gibbsian or Boltzmann average. And that was the equipartition time. And we were also not the first ones to do this. There were papers, there were publications from the 1990s by Cassetti and others. And we were able to stretch their results, to confirm their results, and to stretch them further down to lower energies and therefore much larger equipartitioning times. But what a byproduct was of this is that we realized that we now can also, once we do reach equipartition by this definition, we can actually study the fluctuations in the dynamics of the system at equipartition. And that brings me now very close to what I want to share with you. But before I come to that, there's one more, now more recent motivation of the work we are currently doing. And we heard already excellent lectures by the chairperson, by Volodya Kravtsov, on many body localization. And this is a pedestrian view of this phenomenon focused, condensed into one page. And so if you wish, you could say that if you have one quantum particle in some random potential, then under suitable conditions, say dimensionality is not too big and the potential is carefully chosen, or you know, is uncorrelated random potential, then we have the phenomenon of Anderson localization. And let's even assume that that means that all eigenstates of the single particle problem are localized in space. And then, if you now take many interacting quantum particles, there is an interesting statement, which was a result, which was obtained in this seminal paper by Baskova, Leiner, and Altshuler, 2006, that if you take the ground state of this system, of this now many-body interacting system, and then you consider excited states, which are characterized by finite energy density relatively to this ground state, then there is a critical energy density below which all states are insulating, that is, they contribute with a zero conductivity, if I understand that correctly, to a DC conductivity. And above this critical energy density, you have metallic states which are extended and may contribute to a non-zero conductivity. So that if you replace energy density by a notion of a temperature, you expect that the conductivity is zero up to a critical temperature and then starts to grow. As far as I also can tell, the results are not rigorous in general, but please correct me if I'm wrong. And the origin of the single particle localization is also not so essential. Well, we heard lots of more recent doubts maybe on some of these issues by Valodia, but this is at least what is my condensed little background knowledge on many body localization, which I keep in my mind. But well, as I said, I mean, things become more fuzzy, and I guess one can discuss this in much more detail. But what I want to mention also is that things even went on with claiming or making statements that you can get a many-body localization and a transition in systems which are clean, in systems where the single particle states are not localized. And in particular, there is this recent paper by Pino, Joff, and Altshuler from 2016, where such a non-ergodic, where such a many-body localized phase, and then a metallic regime with a non-ergodic metallic phase, were predicted for a system of superconducting grains coupled by weak links. So, if you wish, by in a system or in a chain of Josephson junctions. And moreover, in this paper, the classical limit of this model was studied, and the conclusion was that even in the classical limit, non-ergodic dynamics can be observed, which is can be interpreted as a remnant of this non-ergodic metallic phase of the corresponding quantum many-body system. And that is when we became interested in particular also in that model, and I want to show you what we found. But if, again, telling you what my view on these questions is that most probably we talk here very often about the dynamics of non-integrable systems in the proximity of an integrable limit. And we want to understand whether the system is ergodic and how long it takes maybe for the system to equilibrate. And then, of course, we have to start asking questions, what is ergodicity? And I think in this room here we have as many definitions of ergodicity perhaps as we have people in the room. But in my case, since I'm talking about classical systems only here, the definition we took is that the infinite time average of an observable equals its average over the accessible phase space. And on the other side, we don't have infinite time at our disposal, so we don't know how to compute that. But what we can do is we can compute finite time averages. But if we compute finite time averages, then these, of course, will depend on the initial conditions. And so we get distributions of finite time averages. And what we then have to ask is how these distributions will converge for large averaging times. Let me just switch to another pointer, because this one is not so good. And right. And so we have to talk about these properties of distributions of finite time averages and their convergence for large averaging times. And I just also want to mention that there is another paper by Oganessian, Pal, and Hughes from 2009, where they studied a classical model of a classical spin chain and tried to spot classical traces of many-body localization and didn't observe them. But now let's go on and let's think a bit what it means to talk about a non-integrable system in proximity of an integrable limit. So say we have a set of actions and angles. Let's even say it's a countable set. And then we can come up with an integrable Hamiltonian, which depends only on the actions. And the actions are the integrals of motion. And then if we want to perturb this, we add another perturbation, which depends on both actions and angles. And then we get a non-integrable system. And the main claim here is that this perturbation spans a certain network of couplings between the actions. So in this cartoon here, you see these points, say each of them corresponds to one action, and this non-integrable perturbation will span a certain coupling network between these actions, expressed through the corresponding equations of motion. And what we think is that the network range of this non-integrable perturbation can fall into different classes and will control to a large extent the actual many-body dynamics in this in the proximity of that integrable limit. And in particular, there are two different cases which we spotted. One is long-range networks and the other one is short-range networks. Here is the very model which was discussed in the paper by Pino, Joffe, and Altschuler. This boils down, in particular in the classical case, to a very simple chain of coupled rotors, as some of us here in the audience would call it. The P's are the charges on the superconducting grains, or the momenta. The Q's are the phases of the superconducting order parameter, or just the angles of some rotors. And Ej is the Josephson energy. Now, if you take that system and you go to large, you drive it into a large energy density or an infinitely large energy density limit, then you actually, upon heating, get into an integrable system of free rotors. This is simply so because the coupling energy is bounded, and the only way to reach large energy densities is to put all the energy into these kinetic energy terms, and therefore, in the very limit, you have an integrable system. The Josephson coupling is therefore the non-integrable perturbation, and it's probably obvious that this is an example of a short-range network, because only nearest neighbor actions in that chain of actions will talk to each other. On the other side, if you take the same system and you go to the limit of low energy densities, then you again reach an integrable limit, but a different one, which is obvious because you can expand this cosine up to quadratic terms only, and you obtain this harmonic chain, which is integrable, but its solutions, its normal modes, and the corresponding actions are extended states in space. The higher order terms coming from this cosine, the first one just a quartic term, are the non-integrable perturbations, so essentially this is just a Fermi-Pasta-Ulam problem. And these will couple all the normal modes with each other, even though you will have some selection rules because of translational invariance of the system. still all the modes will be coupled with each other, and therefore we end up with a long range network. Yeah, so I will now discuss essentially then only results of the short range network limit, which you reach, for instance, when you go to large energy densities. But first we have to agree what to measure. So we have to define our observables. In our case, this seems to be very natural and simple because we want to study the system close to an integrable limit. So let's take the actions of the integrable limit as the observables. These should now, once you're off the limit, fluctuate and on average get values which correspond to some phase space average. And so we will study the dynamics of these actions or of simple monotonous functions of them. But if you have another problem where you are not sure, or maybe you are far from an integrable limit, but you still have some slow relaxation in your system, then the whole, so to say, physics is in the choice of the right observable. So once we have chosen these observables F, we look at their time dependence. They will fluctuate, as you can see here, around some mean. And then we can compute finite time averages of these observables. And then we obtain distributions of these finite time averages. So we will compute, let's say, such a distribution. And then as we will change the averaging time, this distribution will change. And we will look how this happens. And then also, we measure fluctuation times of our observables. That is the times the observable, for instance, takes values larger than its average or smaller than its average, and we can look at the statistics of these fluctuation times, the corresponding distributions of these events, and relate them with the finite time average distributions. And finally, we want to relate all these timescales, which we extract from such a study, with the Lyapunov time, which is nothing but the inverse of the largest Lyapunov exponent. So a few more words on finite time averages. So say F is your observable, you integrate it over finite time, you get an average finite time average F bar, which of course depends on the averaging time and on the, say, initial point in phase space where you started your trajectory. So averaging of all of them gives you a distribution rho, which parametrically depends on the averaging time, capital T itself. And we will in particular be interested in the first moment of this distribution, mu f, and the standard deviation, sigma f. And then what we also can note is that if there is ergodicity in the way we define this, then these distributions, rho, must tend to delta functions in the limit of infinite averaging times. Otherwise, the statement that infinite time averages equal phase space averages cannot be sustained. Yes? So far we will just stick to this simple path. Right, and so these distributions should converge to a delta function, so become infinitely narrow, and the delta function should be located precisely at the value of the phase space average, which is denoted here by this average F. Because it's hidden in the distribution. It is, okay, for one given R, you produce a finite time average F bar. Now you sample over all your available phase space points R. For instance, a fixed total energy of your system. You mean how I technically do that? Is that your question? No, ideally you will just do it for all of them. I can. Okay, I will assume that there is a uniform distribution, yes. Every point in phase space, the available phase space is essentially the space of constant, let's say, total energy, or subject maybe to other integrals of motion, and each point has the same weight. Yeah. That's how I at least understand it. But of course, we cannot sample all the points. You could even, in principle, take one initial point and follow the trajectory, and it will bring you to many other points and use them as initial conditions. You could. But, I mean, it's a sensitive point, you're absolutely right. Right, and so in order to quantitatively characterize this narrowing down of this finite time average distributions, what we will compute this fluctuation index little q, which is the ratio of the variance or the squared standard deviation sigma f squared divided by the square of the first moment. So this is a dimensionless quantity, and it should tend to zero in the limit of infinite averaging times if the system is ergodic. Good point. Then we have to think about something different. Because we need, for us this is important because we avoid dimensionality effects. Yeah. You probably could take some other quantity of order one which has this the proper dimension. Yeah, and then what appears to happen is that this fluctuation index, of course, when this averaging time is much smaller than some ergodization time, which is now our main goal, or which we want to reach, we want to get these numbers, then this little q will be just a constant. But for large times, averaging times capital T, it will tend to zero as 1 over capital T, and the numerator is the time scale which controls this process, and that's what we call ergodization time. And here you see some examples of such calculations. Q depends on this averaging time, capital T, everything in log scales. The black line is one example, and then as we go closer and closer to the integrable limit, we see that this process of decay is postponed, but it still happens, which means that the ergodization time grows, but is still finite, until it will escape from our available time window, which we can access, and then we cannot, strictly speaking, say anything. Right, on the other side, there are these events, which I already mentioned. So the times the observable spends in an event while being larger than its average or smaller. So we can therefore take a trajectory and fragment it into these events and take the time of each event and construct corresponding distributions. The event times are called tau, and then distributions are called p. Before we had the distributions rho, which correspond to the finite time averages, and now we have distributions p, which tell you how these event times are distributed. Sorry. Yeah. And again, for these event time distributions p, we compute the first moment and the standard deviation. And now comes a lot of fuzzy statements, which are not well proven, perhaps, but I think intuition seems to work, at least in these cases. Namely, these distributions should have a finite first and second moment, and at least that's what they show in our numerics, and perhaps at the integrable limit they might tend to asymptotically to 1 over tau squared, but whenever we are off the limit, and if we assume that the system is ergodic, then by the theorem of Katz and the assumption that we have finite recurrence times, it follows that this distribution must decay asymptotically faster than 1 over tau squared. And this is what we actually see here. This is this distribution P of the event times. Just look at the solid lines. So it falls off, log log again, of course, as a function of log of tau. So it somehow falls off. This black line here is the 1 over tau squared line. And what you see is as we come closer to the integrable limit, these distributions align for longer and longer windows with this 1 over tau squared law, only to finally deviate again from it. And you see that better if you take the derivatives of these lines in this log-log representation, and you plot these derivatives as a function again. So it's essentially the slopes here as a function of log of tau. And so you see as you come closer and closer to the integrable limit, then these derivatives stay for longer and longer periods close to minus 2, only to finally go down, indicating that there's some kind of exponential cutoff. So therefore, if you assume such a picture, what you can then come up with is that in the integrable limit, the first moment of these distributions might well tend to infinity, the standard deviation as well, but most importantly also the ratio of the standard deviation to the first moment will diverge, which means that extreme events are not rare but typical, because the standard deviation becomes much larger than the average. Yeah, and then finally, if we approximate this time dependence of our observable very brutally by a telegraph noise, which in particular means that we remove all correlations between events, even those which follow one after the other, one after each other, what we can show is that the ergodization time is nothing but the squared standard deviation of the distribution of the event times divided by the corresponding first moment. And well, that's basically it. And now comes the big question, how are all these timescales related to the Lyapunov time, which you can also compute, and which is the inverse of the largest Lyapunov exponent. Here are all the times again in one slide. So the Lyapunov time, T lambda, the ergodization time down here, TE, which tells you how these finite time average distributions converge, and then the first and second moment or standard deviation of the distribution of the fluctuation or event times, mu t and sigma t. And what happens apparently is the following. For a long-range network, the Lyapunov time is of the order, and this is a pure numerical result, there's no analytical substance to that. The Lyapunov time is of the order of the standard deviation of the event times. And I remind you that what we can show is that the ergodization time is given by the square of sigma tau divided by mu tau. So in the case of a long-range network, the Lyapunov time is essentially sigma tau. And therefore, the ergodization time is essentially the square, scales as the square of the Lyapunov time. So one could say that the Lyapunov time controls the ergodization process in that sense. On the other side, for a short-range network, the Lyapunov time is of the order of the first moment of the event or fluctuation times and turns irrelevant for the estimate and even the scaling of the ergodization time in the vicinity of an integrable limit. And I will say a few more words on what actually then is controlling this ergodization. Now back to the model, which I already discussed. This is our system of coupled, weakly coupled superconducting grains, or Joseon junction chain. We have seen already this figure, which is the distribution P of the event or fluctuation times tau, where we see an indication that we have, as we come closer to the integrable limit, this distribution aligns for longer and longer, for larger and larger windows to 1 over tau squared, which means that the standard deviation grows much faster than the first moment. So we have extreme events of very long time fluctuations, which however are not rare but typical. On the other side, again, the finite time averages lead to distributions, and these distributions are characterized by this index little q, which roughly measures the width of the distribution, and we have seen this also. We get indeed a decay of this index for large averaging times, which means in that sense that the system is ergodic, in that sense. Yes, thank you. So the Josephson energy here is chosen to be 1. So this Ej is 1. And we vary the energy density H. So it's the total energy divided by the volume. Yeah, but we go here to, here I discuss only the large energy density limit. Okay, so this is 0.1. 1, what is it then? 1.2, I guess. 2.4, and so on. I hope we have everything here, right? So as we go up, we go with the energy density up. Yes, this is a small energy density. But you see, we have chosen, in some sense, if we want to study that limit of low energy densities, we have to choose different observables. So these observables won't tell you anything. It looks very nice, right? But you have to look at the other ones, these low variables, and then surprises will come out in this low energy density limit. But here I'm not focusing on that. And I just want to show you also here, this, for instance, this red curve here corresponds to one of these energy densities. You see that this index Q becomes small, and there are two dots here, and they correspond to these two distributions, finite time average distributions, and you see how these distributions become more narrow as you increase the averaging time. Yeah, and this is the condensed main figure, namely the right one first. Again, this is for Ej equal 1. And we now plot here all the timescales which we find. Maybe I should go on to this side. As a function of the energy density. Everything again on log scales. So first let's have a look at the event times or the fluctuation times. They have a first moment mu. And they have the standard deviation sigma. And you see somewhere here, the standard deviation becomes much larger than the first moment. So you get a very fat tail in these corresponding distributions, capital P. The Lyapunov time is this violet curve. It doesn't show anything. It actually seems even to go down as you increase the energy density, but it will go up eventually. But it's clearly not very much related to these time scales, which you see up there. On the other side, the ergodization time, which we extract from the finite time average distributions, is the green line. And if I take sigma squared divided by mu, and multiply it with one number A, which I have to fit, I get the black line, so I get very good agreement between the ergodization time scale and the time scale which I can find from these event time distributions. So this is an example of what we would call then a dynamical glass, where we have a huge ergodization time, but a very small Lyapunov time. You can get the same thing if you instead of changing the energy density, fix the energy density to anything, for instance to 1, and then you vary the constant Ej, which is the Josephson energy. And if this Josephson energy goes to zero, you essentially again decouple your superconducting grains, and that's the same type of short-range network limit being in the proximity of an integrable system means making this Ej very small. And we see essentially the same features as in the right figure, so I don't have to iterate them once again. Yes. I don't understand that. Let's go back. Which figure do you want to use to show that? This one here? No, I don't believe anything. I just measure. Okay, actually, it's not me. It's the other co-authors. So we measure these distributions. You know, whether there's a 1/1000. So these are the distributions, these solid lines. For each of them, of course, I can only obtain them up to somewhere, right? I mean, look at this, it's 10 to minus 12. No, we do that, and we see, and what we see is that we get the same curves. Maybe we can extend them a little bit further down. No. As far as I can tell, no. This 1/1000 squared is just for us to discuss. I could just remove it and just say this is what we get from the numbers. And yes, I think I can confirm that the moments do not depend on these, if you wish, cutoff times here. I mean, it's just that we need lots of statistics to make a point here, and that for a PDF which falls down to 10 to minus 12. Okay, at some point you have to give up. Yeah, and so what happens actually in this dynamical glass phase, either here at large energy densities or down here at very small Josephson junction constants, is the following. So here's an example for Ej equal 1 and energy density 5.4. What we plot here in the left part is the space-time dependence of the energy densities, and what we actually do is we just make a black point if the energy density on the given, or the energy on the given rotor or superconducting grain, is larger than its phase space average, and if it's below that, we just don't plot anything, and that makes these events we were talking about very nicely visible. And you see that this is, for instance, here running from 100,000 to 200,000, and there are quite a number of events which apparently take much longer times. But there, of course, also are events which are much shorter, which correspond to these little points here, point-like structures which you see. On the other side, if you, for the same space-time window, try to define a resonance in pretty much along the lines which we heard from Volodya Kravtsov, a resonance between nearest neighbor rotors or superconducting grains who interact with each other, which may indicate that these groups of rotors might develop chaos, because we have a nonlinear resonance, and if we have a nonlinear resonance, we can expect that there will be chaotic dynamics. So the locations of these resonances are shown here again in black for the same time window. So what you see is that they are there. The system in principle is chaotic. Each of these resonances will be characterized, say, by some chaotic dynamics, and will be characterized by this Lyapunov time, which we discussed before. But these Lyapunov, chaotic spots are localized and need a very long time to migrate through the whole system. And this kind of very slow diffusion of these, as further up you go in the energy density, less dense distributions of resonances, is the reason for the substantial delay of the ergodization of these systems. And it might be an interesting question what will happen if you now just, as a very intelligent person, quantize this system, so go back to a quantum many-body problem. What will happen to those resonances? Will they be killed or will they survive? Will you get some kind of, will you get something which you could call an MBL phase or not? I don't know. But that's what's happening. As you go up in the energy density, as you go closer to this short-range network characterized integrable limit, you will find that these resonances become more and more rare and will take humongous times to migrate through the whole system. Yeah, that's actually everything. So there are lots of open issues, more than I listed here, of course. And we discussed already some of them, but maybe I should just mention that it's an interesting question what will happen if you add additional integrals of motion to your system, or if you have some continuous symmetries, for instance. How will the system relax? We don't know much. We don't know how really the dynamics inside this dynamical glass, the ergodization dynamics goes on, how these chaotic and regular spots or puddles slowly migrate, and why, and what the time scales are which set these processes. There might be additional dimensionality impacts of the original system on additional maybe phases or regimes in this dynamical glass. And I mentioned already quantization questions. Right, and the take-home messages are that we think a lot of this also maybe the discussions of many-body localization physics are related to the dynamics of systems in the proximity of an integrable limit. And then what we advocate is that these dynamics, these proximity dynamics, is characterized by networks which can be either long or short range. Of course, you can also invent other cases where the things are more fuzzy, but in the easy cases which we looked at, they are typically either long or short range. In the long range case, we have a relatively nice ergodization dynamics, chaotic resonances, nonlinear resonances, which lead to chaotic dynamics between groups of actions, can spread very efficiently into the rest of this network because of the long rangeness of this network. While if you have a short range network, things become very different. And in particular, also the Lyapunov time is not a good measure for how long you have to wait in order to reach ergodicity. Still, it looks like the trajectory covers the whole available phase space, but now, of course, we go into the question whether our working definition of ergodicity is good enough or not, but it could at least do that. And in this regime of the what we call dynamical glass, the dynamics fragments into long-lived, regular, and chaotic patches. Yeah, and that's basically the end of the story. Thank you for your attention.